name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. John and Elizabeth, the Church shares your joy and warmly welcomes you together with your families and friends, as today in the presence of God our Father, you establish between yourselves a lifelong partnership. May the Lord hear you on this your joyful day. May he send you help from heaven and protect you. May he grant you your heart's desire and fulfill every one of your prayers. Glory to God in the highest. Let us pray. O God, who consecrated the bond of marriage by so great a mystery that in the wedding covenant you foreshadow the sacrament of Christ and his church, grant, we pray, to these your servants that what they receive in faith they may live out in deeds. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Please be seated as we listen to a reading from the Holy Scriptures.
A reading from the first letter of St. Peter. Beloved, you wives should be subordinate to your husbands so that, even if some disobey the word, they may be won over without a word by their wives' conduct when they observe your reverent and chaste behavior. Your adornment should not be an external one, braiding the hair, wearing gold jewelry, or dressing in fine clothes, but rather the hidden character of the heart, expressed in the imperishable beauty of a gentle and calm disposition, which is precious in the sight of God. For this is also how the holy women who hoped in God once used to adorn themselves and were subordinate to their husbands. Thus Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord. You are her children when you do what is good and fear no intimidation. Likewise, you husbands should live with your wives in understanding, showing honor to the weaker female sex, since we are joint heirs of the gift of life, so that your prayers may not be hindered. Finally, all of you be of one mind, sympathetic, loving toward one another, compassionate, humble. Do not return evil for evil or insult for insult, but, on the contrary, a blessing, because to this you were called, that you might inherit a blessing. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, let mutual love continue. Do not neglect hospitality, for through it some have unknowingly entertained angels. Be mindful of prisoners as if sharing their imprisonment, and of the ill-treated as of yourselves. For you also are in the body. Let marriage be honored among all, and the marriage bed be kept undefiled. Let your life be free from love of money, but be content with what you have. For he has said, I will never forsake you or abandon you. Thus we may say with confidence, the Lord is my helper, and I will not be afraid. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. There was a wedding in Cana in Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples were also invited to the wedding. When the wine ran short, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, how does your concern affect me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now, there were 6 stone water jars there for Jewish ceremonial washings, each holding 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus told them, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, "Draw some out now and take it to the head waiter." So they took it. And when the head waiter tasted the water that had become wine, without knowing where it came from, although the servants who had drawn the water knew, the head waiter called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves good wine first, and then when people have drunk freely, an inferior one. But you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this as the beginning of his signs in Cana in Galilee, and so revealed his glory, and his disciples began to believe in him. The Gospel of the Lord. A little girl at a wedding asked the mom, she said, "Mom, why do brides always wear white?" The mom replied, "Because they are happy, my dear." Halfway through the wedding, the girl whispered again to the mom, "Mom, if brides wear white because they are happy, then why do men wear black?" Don't feel bad, John. This happened to me 3 days ago. My parents are visiting from Nigeria, and we went to Walmart. My mom was wearing a white gown because we were coming from Mass. We wanted to buy some fruits. And I was wearing my clerical wear, black, with the Roman collar. Standing beside the fruits, one woman was smiling, running towards us, and came to tell my own mother, "Congratulations." My mom was like, and she said, "You all just got married?" So I got married to my mom 3 days ago. Well, as some of you may know, I'm the chaplain of Wake Forest University, as well as North Carolina A&T, and that was where I met Lizzie, and we prayed together several times and talked together about life, and she made so many good impacts in the lives of so many students on that campus, in the life of our Catholic community, and also even in my own life as a priest. And like I told her last night, as I was coming for this wedding, one of my students who just became Catholic, who is also a twin, like you, John, texted me yesterday morning while I was in the airport. She said, say hello to the new couple. But first, I need three pictures. One of the bride, one of the wedding gown, and one of the ring. The ring was in bold letters. If at some point you see me holding my phone, just know I have an assignment from my students. I want to congratulate you both, Lizzie and John, for everything you did to make this day happen. Psalm 118 verse 24 says, this is the day made by the Lord. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Congratulations also to both of your families, friends, and well-wishers. I know everyone must have made some sacrifices in love for this ceremony. This is not the end, my dear friends. This is the beginning of a lifelong journey. And I'm sure everyone here has come to rejoice and to thank God with you while praying along for many more blessings to come through the grace of God and the intercession of our Blessed Mother Mary, Queen and Mother of all families. I have no doubt that this is a marriage made in heaven. Sitting last night at dinner with the family of John, I was sitting with Mary Kate, Michael, Carla, Christine, Gracie, Helen, Edmund, and of course Peter serving on this mass. And a question came up at that table concerning today's homily from Mary Kate. That question actually made me to reflect through the night and to rephrase the words of this homily today. Because some of my former students who may have come to some of the weddings I presided at and preached are here. So they want to watch out if I just come to repeat homilies at every weddings of alumni. No, I will shock you today. In the book of Genesis chapter 2 verse 18, God said, I will make him a helper. I will make him a helper. And the Hebrew word that describes helper is Ezer, E-Z-E-R, Ezer. It appears 21 times in the Old Testament. And it means any of these three things. One, a woman as a helpmate. Two, a military aid for the Israelites who were at war. And then three, God as Israel's helper. One word having these three meanings. So therefore, a woman will be seen as one who comes to the rescue, who comes to save, because she's very strong. This is the original biblical understanding of the word Ezer as it describes the woman. And you know, Lizzie did something no other student has ever done for me in Wake Forest University, okay? I'm gonna expose Lizzie now, so be prepared. I've been there for 9 years. Students are wonderful in so many ways. But this young woman, as a sophomore or junior, drove one day all the way from Atlanta. First, she stopped by at a Nigerian restaurant, asking them, what kind of food can I buy for my priest who is Nigerian? And they gave her several options. She didn't know what they were talking about. She just said, anything you think a Nigerian would like, serve it for me in a takeaway bowl, and then I know what to do. And then she drove all the way to campus, called me, I have something for you. I was wondering, I wasn't expecting that call, but I said, okay. And then she came to meet me in my office and presented this big bowl of jollof rice and chicken and fried plantain. And I ate and ate and ate. I haven't forgotten that meal. And Lizzie, thank you once again. And if you could do this for me, I know you will do several things more for John. Not pressure, okay? So John, you are in very good hands. Her mom actually told me she has the thinking of a grandmother because she goes way beyond herself to help everyone else. Sitting with your family and knowing Lizzie so well, knowing your families, I have no fears and I have no doubt that this is a marriage made from heaven. Saint Augustine, one of the fathers of the church, said these words: the woman was made of a rib out of the side of Adam, not made out of his head to rule over him, nor out of his feet to be trampled upon, but out of his side to be equal with him, under his arm to be protected, and near his heart to be beloved. This summarizes all of the readings we have heard today. Why, both of you, we have to walk together. We have to pray together. We have to journey together. And the best analogy I can use to describe the moment both of you set eyes on each other till now and going forward is the analogy of a building. I guess you are wondering, what is the connection between a building and marriage? The most important part of a house is largely invisible. So much so that normally we don't even talk about it, but a builder does. In fact, it is the very first thing he thinks about, and that is the foundation. The foundation of a building must be deep and solid. In a word, rock-like. The wise builder takes their time. They will not be rushed. They think far into the future. They know that the fate of the building and its occupants will depend on the soundness of the foundation. They get well prepared. The foolish builder on the other side is in a hurry. They can't be bothered to go down deep, and they are not too concerned about the quality of the materials they use. They do not look to the future. Their only concern is to get the building up as quickly and cheaply as possible. Building a marriage could be compared to building a house. Like a house, it does not appear overnight. A couple do not take possession of the home of marriage already made on their wedding day. It must be built. In building it, it is essential that both of you look to the future, because the home must last, not just for a few years, not just for some time, but for the rest of their lives. And you can take a cue from this when you see the lives of your parents. And you know you can be sure that some gales will be let loose upon the building. Hence the importance of laying down a good foundation, solid and deep. Deep in your faith, deep in prayer, deep in love, deep in respect for one another. You must build not on sand, but on solid rock. Remember the story in Matthew chapter 7, verse 24 to 27. Christ is my rock, my refuge, my stronghold. Any building that stands on that rock of Christ will always be solid, will last, will be strong. No kind of weapon fashioned against it shall prosper. No amount of hurricane or tornado or gale can move it. That is the marriage founded on a solid rock. What both of you are called to build is not a building of stones and bricks, but a small community, one in which you will be able to find acceptance, a sense of belonging, warmth, security, and peace. Psalm 127, verse 1 says, "Unless the Lord builds the house, in vain do the builders labor." It is very appropriate that we are starting this marriage on this day in the presence of the priests, the people, but most importantly, in the presence of the Lord. And like your dad reminded us yesterday, this is the only sacrament that is not presided over by a priest, or that is not celebrated by a priest or a bishop or a deacon, but by the couple themselves getting married. So it's a very special sacrament. Without this, even though you may be living in a mansion, you won't find what you are looking for if it is not built on the Lord. So, on behalf of every one of us here, we pray that the home of your marriage, Lizzie and John, will be solid and sturdy with God's help. We pray also that both of you will find in it what your hearts are longing for. Congratulations on behalf of Father Peter and everyone gathered here. I wish you God's abundant blessing and a peaceful and prosperous married life.
John and Elizabeth, at this time I invite you, together with your wedding party, to come to the altar for the celebration of holy matrimony. Dearly beloved, you have come together into the house of the church so that in the presence of the church's minister and the community, your intention to enter into marriage may be strengthened by the Lord with a sacred seal. Christ abundantly blesses the love that binds you. Through a special sacrament, he enriches and strengthens those he has already consecrated by holy baptism, that they may be faithful to each other forever and assume all the responsibilities of married life. And so, in the presence of the church, I ask you to state your intentions. John and Elizabeth, have you come here to enter into marriage without coercion, freely and wholeheartedly? Are you prepared, as you follow the path of marriage, to love and honor each other for as long as you both shall live? Are you prepared to accept children lovingly from God and to bring them up according to the law of Christ and his church? Since it is your intention to enter the covenant of holy matrimony, I invite you to enter the sanctuary and join your right hands and declare your consent before God and his church.
I, John, take you, Elizabeth, for my lawful wife, to have and to hold, from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish, until death do us part.
I, Elizabeth, take you, John, for my lawful husband, to have and to hold, from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish, until death do us part.
May the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, the God who joined together our first parents in paradise, strengthen and bless in Christ the consent you have declared before the church, so that what God joins together, no one may put asunder. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. May the Lord bless these rings, which you will give to each other as a sign of love and fidelity. Elizabeth, receive this ring as a sign of my love and fidelity. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
John, receive this ring as a sign of my love and fidelity. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Dear brothers and sisters, as we call to mind the special gift of grace and charity by which God has been pleased to crown and consecrate the love of our sister Elizabeth and our brother John, let us commend them to the Lord.
That these faithful Christians, Elizabeth and John, newly joined in holy matrimony, may always enjoy health and well-being, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That he will bless their covenant as he chose to sanctify marriage at Cana in Galilee, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the grace of the sacrament will be renewed by the Holy Spirit in all married persons here present, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the Wade and Asik families and their relatives and friends, and for all who have assisted this couple, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all members of the Wade and Asik families who have passed from this world, especially Julia Matchett, that they enjoy eternal life with our Lord, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Graciously pour out upon this husband and wife, O Lord, the spirit of your love, to make them one heart and one soul, so that nothing whatever may divide those you have joined, and no harm come to those you have filled with your blessing, through Christ our Lord. Please be seated.
Thank you.
incense.
Holy Spirit, in contrite heart, be accepted by your Lord, may your sacrifice and your sight this day be pleasing to your Lord God. Incense. Please rise. Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Receive, we pray, O Lord, the offering made on the occasion of this sealing of the sacred bond of marriage. And just as your goodness is its origin, may your providence guide its course. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you have forged the covenant of marriage as a sweet yoke of harmony and an unbreakable bond of peace, so that the chaste and fruitful love of holy matrimony may serve to increase the children you adopt as your own. By your providence and grace, O Lord, you accomplish the wonder of this twofold design, that while the birth of children brings beauty to the world, their rebirth in baptism gives increase to the Church through Christ our Lord. Through him, with the angels and all the saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim.
Thank you.
Please kneel or be seated. To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world. Together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Gregory John, our Archbishop, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here, whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, for they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord, Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protecting help, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, the offering of your servants, John and Elizabeth, and of your whole family, who entreat your majesty on their behalf. And as you have brought them to their wedding day, so gladden them with your gift of the children they desire, and bring them in your kindness to the length of days for which they hope, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands. And once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty, from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with a sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants who do sin us, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Please rise. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Dear brothers and sisters, let us humbly pray to the Lord that on these his servants, now married in Christ, he may mercifully pour out the blessing of his grace and make of one heart in love by the sacrament of Christ's body and blood those he has joined by a holy covenant. O God, who by your mighty power created all things out of nothing, and when you had set in place the beginnings of the universe, formed man and woman in your own image, making the woman an inseparable helpmate to the man, that they might no longer be two, but one flesh, and taught that what you were pleased to make one must never be divided. O God, who consecrated the bond of marriage by so great a mystery, that in the wedding covenant you foreshadowed the sacrament of Christ and his church. O God, by whom woman is joined to man, and the companionship they had in the beginning is endowed with the one blessing not forfeited by original sin, nor washed away by the flood. Look now with favor on these your servants, joined together in marriage, who ask to be strengthened by your blessing. Send down on them the grace of the Holy Spirit, and pour your love into their hearts, that they may remain faithful in the marriage covenant. May the grace of love and peace abide in your daughter Elizabeth, and let her always follow the example of those holy women whose praises are sung in the scriptures. May her husband entrust his heart to her, so that acknowledging her as his equal and his joint heir to the life of grace, he may show her due honor and cherish her always with the love that Christ has for his church. And now, Lord, we implore you, may these your servants hold fast to the faith and keep your commandments. Made one in the flesh, may they be blameless in all they do. And with the strength that comes from the gospel, may they bear true witness to Christ before all. May they be blessed with children and prove themselves virtuous parents who live to see their children's children. And grant that, reaching at last together the fullness of years for which they hope, they may come to the life of the blessed in the kingdom of heaven. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer one another the sign of peace. Please kneel or be seated. In a moment, we will have the distribution of Holy Communion, and just a word of instruction at this point. We are so grateful for all who have joined us here today of different faiths, and we are glad to be gathered together here in prayer. In a moment, if you are a practicing Catholic, you may join the line to come and receive Holy Communion. If you're not Catholic or not prepared to receive communion today, you may join the line to receive a blessing at the altar. Simply when you approach myself or Father Marcel, just cross your arms over your chest like this, and we'll be happy to give you a blessing. Or if you prefer, you may remain in your pew at this time and join us in prayer. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Please rise. Let us pray. By the power of this sacrifice, O Lord, accompany with your loving favor what in your providence you have instituted, so as to make of one heart in love those you have already joined in this holy union and replenished with the one bread and the one chalice, through Christ our Lord. Amen. John Elizabeth, this time I invite you with your wedding party to the altar for the final blessing. May God, the Eternal Father, keep you of one heart in love for one another, that the peace of Christ may dwell in you and abide always in your home. Amen. May you be blessed in your children, have solace in your friends, and enjoy true peace with everyone. Amen. May you be witnesses in the world to God's charity, so that the afflicted and needy who have known your kindness may one day receive you thankfully into the eternal dwelling of God. Amen. And may Almighty God bless all of you who are gathered here, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
And it is my great pleasure to present to you Mr. and Mrs. Asik.